It'll only be myself and Dr. Katy Owen who'll be captured in the recording. But if you do feel uncomfortable with the lecture being recorded, unfortunately, we will have to ask you to leave the talk and you can watch the recording back in your own time. The recording will be sent to you roughly a week after this talk because we need to caption and edit it. And you'll also get kind of a reading list if you want to explore some of the topics a bit further in your own time. This evening, you should have received in the Eventbrite email information about using Menti. It's very straightforward. If you've not used Menti before, you essentially go to menti.com and then you'll type in the code and that will align with the talk we've got tonight. And it just allows you to be responding to things in real time and makes the talk a bit more interactive. But you'll get the code for that when we start the talk. And if you've got any problems with that, feel free to just post it in the chat. If you're struggling with how to use it, we can help you with that. If you've got any questions throughout the lecture, please use the Q&A function instead of the chat, just because then we can make sure we don't lose any of the questions as we go through. And there'll be a time at the end, about 10 to 15 minutes, where we'll respond to questions. However, if they're kind of medicine related, as in like admissions, like applying to medical school, that kind of thing, myself or one of my colleagues will reply to those as we go through the talk. Also, if you've got anything that needs clarifying, if there's any terminology used that you're not sure about, or you're just a bit confused about something, please post that in the Q&A and we'll respond to that immediately, just so everyone's up to speed and knows what's going on. We don't want anyone lost or confused. As outlined in the Eventbrite page as well, we're going to be talking about some difficult topics tonight. You should have received a resources list if you need any support and to signpost you to different services if you're affected by anything that we talk about tonight. As we're a UK-based institution, the resources list reflects that. If at any time you need to kind of step away and have a breather, please feel free to do that. And if and when you're able to, you can join us again. And lastly, a reminder that the talk has been designed for students aged 11 to 18. So if you've got anyone in the background wandering around under that age, please be aware that this talk will not be suitable for them. Great, I think that's all of our housekeeping tonight. I will now hand over to Dr. Katy Owen, who will be delivering the talk this evening. Thanks, everyone.
So hi, everybody. It is super exciting to be here. Okay, I'm just going to share my screen. She says. Okay. Hopefully you should be able to see that, fingers crossed. Okay, so yes, hi everybody. It is absolutely so exciting to see so many people here. So thank you so much for coming. So yes, my name is Dr. Katy Owen, hi. My talk is called Difficult Discussions as a Doctor, Life, Death, and All the Messy Bits in Between. And I did come up with that title on my own. And I'm a junior doctor, so it's from my perspective. I'm not like a consultant. I haven't been a doctor for years and years. I've got quite, I think, quite probably a fresh perspective on it. So I wanted to share that with you all. Okay, so before we start, I probably should tell you a bit about like who I am. Alice very kindly offered to introduce me, but I said I would just cringe away in the background if she did that. So I thought I'd introduce myself. So I'm Katy. I actually used to go to Brighton Sussex Medical School. It's great. And I used to be a Bright Med mentor and I really miss it. They're great. I currently live in Sheffield and I am training to be a GP and I've been a doctor for about 4 and a bit years by now. And I'm also a clinical teacher at the University of Sheffield Medical School, which is also really fun. I like teaching. So, just a little warning, I think Alice has already said this, but these are the kind of things we're talking about. It doesn't get too doom and gloom, I promise. I'm telling a couple of stories about sad things, but, you know, don't worry too much. I think it'll be interesting more than it will be sad. You will need a pen and paper, old school. If you haven't got a pen and paper or just a scrap of paper or something, you won't need it for very much. Just grab one now. We're making notes, writing down some important words. You'll need a phone, as said earlier. So for Menti, you just need a way of getting to Mentimeter. And we're going to do that now just to test that people are awake and here. And also because I'm really curious to see who is actually here. Okay. So This is the bit where I do tech. Bear with. Okay. Hopefully you should be able to see the screen saying go to menti.com and there's the code at the top. I hope that that's worked. If it hasn't worked, Alice, please feel free to tell me it's not worked. Yes, it has worked. Yay! Oh, people are from everywhere. Hi, everybody. Well, lots of people are from London. Ooh. And people are from Sheffield too. Yay, Sheffield. Hi, Sheffield people. I'm just going to let this carry on because loads of places. I'm really nosy. That's basically why I've done this. Oh, this is going very well. Right, London, Manchester, they're pretty big. Brighton, as I would expect. Glasgow, Cambridge, Slough, Newcastle, Lyme, Buckinghamshire, Liverpool. Berwick-upon-Tweed, I went there on holiday once, it was nice. Hastings, Cheltenham. Ah, this is so fab. I can see Singapore in there somewhere as well. And Mumbai as well, oh, so exciting. Guys, this is fabulous. I could sit here and read this all day, but I do want to move on because my next question is, I'm sorry, I'm being mean, I'm moving it on. How old are you? I am hoping mostly for like 11 to 18 year olds. I mean, this will be interesting if you're a medical student, to be fair, or if you are a student in university, or if you are, I don't know, probably not a doctor. I might be telling you things you already know if you're a doctor. Be very welcome here anyway. Oh, that's good. So most of you guys are in this age bracket. Excellent. Cool. Okay. You can carry on adding to it, but I'm not going to look at it now because I'm going to go back to my slides. Okay. Can you see the look of concentration? Okay, right, back to my slides. So, what are we talking about today? I'm going to start by talking about us. So like me and you, our own personal experiences of difficult conversations, because I think that's a really good place to start. And I also think that our own experiences can help us learn how to deal with the experience when it's happening to somebody else. And I'm going to talk about the big life stuff, because there's lots of big life stuff that can happen to people. And then we're going to talk about doctors and where they come in with the difficult conversations and the big life stuff. We're going to talk about how to say the right thing and be really nice about it. It is more difficult than first appears. And also empathy, which might be something that you've heard of, might be something that you've become completely sick of, or might be something that's very new to you. But I think it's really super important, to be fair, empathy. So we'll talk about that too, because it's my talk and we can talk about what I want to talk about, which is fun. Okay, so, and then to finish, we're going to do story time. So I'm just going to tell you a couple of stories about difficult conversations that I've had. Because I think that's quite nice, especially when I always remember wanting to kind of hear lived experience of stuff. So, and then a collective debrief, which will be interesting. Okay. Are you ready for the soul searching to begin? What is the most awkward conversation that you've ever had? Just think to yourself now. Just have a little think. I'll tell you what mine is. My most awkward conversation is when I broke up with my very nice 17-year-old boyfriend when I was 17. And it was terribly awkward. It was terribly awkward. I didn't fancy him anymore. Anyway, enough of that. It might be that it was about breaking up with somebody or even falling out with a friend, perhaps, or a family member. It might be something that you were really embarrassed about. Maybe you did something wrong, I don't know. Something awkward happened, no one knew how to react. I'm going to do a Menti for this because I think we can't see it in the chat. Remember, on the Menti poll, you are anonymous. So if you can just think of a little sentence that you can put on the Menti poll, we shall do this now. Okay. what is the most awkward conversations you've ever had? It's anonymous. I won't judge you. Oh, definitely the sex talk. Definitely. Oh, yes. Yes, that's true, actually, to be fair. Therapy coming out. Farting. There's always one. Don't be crude. Coming out to my mum, telling my parents I had a boyfriend. Coming out to my friends. Opening up about mental health. Someone asked me out, I had to say no. When you broke the test tube in biology. If I speak, I'm in trouble. How do I do this? I'm trying to scroll. Anyone, Alice or whoever, I'm trying to scroll and it's not scrolling.
It might be because people are still submitting answers. So I think it scrolls automatically.
Oh, okay. I'm looking at the number in the bottom and thinking, oh, there's 150 replies and I can't see them, but it's okay.
I think that's right.
Breaking up, rejecting someone, super awkward. Getting stuck on a chair with glue on, I mean, that is a little bit awkward. When my friend, oh, that's interesting. When my friend slipped in conversation, his mum died of cancer. So just slipped in and it was terribly, I'm guessing, awkward. Puberty, sex, yeah, boys. Hopefully it's something, the sex talk's coming up quite a lot, which is actually really interesting. Breaking up with my boyfriend. First period is interesting. Yeah, it's awkward. Okay, the same thing's coming up again and again, which is interesting. If I haven't read what you've put, don't worry, because it's just nice to just write it down sometimes. Okay, I'm going to pause that there. You can carry on if you like, but I won't be able to see it. And I'm going to go back to our next question, because that was what's awkward. But really what we're talking about today is stuff that's really sad and difficult. And this is the sad low point of the presentation. Don't worry, it picks up from here, but I do want you to think about a time that you were just super sad or something was really upsetting. I'll tell you my sad moment from my personal life was finding out that a family member had cancer. That was just, oh, it was just awful. So that's my sad moment. Yours might be family or friends being sick or passing away or being unwell. Someone gets a diagnosis, perhaps as a breakup of a parent relationship, that can be really hard. People did mention breakups in the last one, but if you had a breakup of a relationship that meant a lot to you, that can be completely awful. Telling your parents about something maybe bad that had happened. Or maybe it was just supporting a friend who was really upset. It just made you really, really sad, which would be completely fair enough. Okay, we'll go back to our little mentee. Oh, no, we're not going back to Menti. That's why it's not worked. Bear with me a second. What I would like you to do, this is just me faffing with technology. There we go. What I would like you to do is, and I've even written a little note to myself and I forgot it, write it down in your paper for later. There you go. Yes, I made the decision and forgot I made the decision that it will probably be better not to put this in the mentee. I do want you to write it down. I do want you to remember it if it was something very sad. Hopefully you've thought of something by now. And we're going to come back to that later. Gets back on track very quickly. Well done, Katy. Okay, so today we are dealing with big life stuff. We are going to talk about death. I'm sorry about that, but we are. The D word and also the C words, which there's two of them now, cancer and coronavirus. If anyone's interested, I have my coronavirus vaccine today. Super exciting. But yes, we'll be talking about cancer. We'll be talking about coronavirus. Relationships, we'll be talking about sex a little bit, not a huge amount. Mostly because sex is usually positive, you'd hope. You or someone close to you becoming very ill, embarrassing bodies, when they malfunction horribly, mental health, And then just the idea of when humans are not very nice to other humans, if you're being bullied or harassed or safeguarding, that's the kind of stuff that's big and to do with life and comes with all these big emotions, which are kind of obvious. I've just written them down, but they're obvious emotions, big, nasty emotions that can be very upsetting, very difficult to handle, and quite understandably come along with talking about these big things that aren't so nice that happen in people's lives. Okay, right. So next task for you. On your piece of paper, I would like you to make a tally of your life experience so far of difficult stuff. So if one of the issues that I put up in the next three slides applies to you, I want you to make a little tally. So when I say applies to you, it directly, something like, for example, I don't know, you've been unwell, childhood illness, you've been really, really unwell, you had to go into hospital, or perhaps a sibling of yours was really unwell. I want you to make a tally of when these things have happened to you. You get one for each. It's not a competition. Not a competition. I just want to see what people's tallies are. So if any of these things have resulted in a difficult discussion or have directly applied to you in some way, I want you to make a tally. Give you a bit of time to read those. We're just writing the tallies on a piece of paper. Okay, possibly you've done a couple of them, tally, maybe a couple more. All right, next one. When it works. Now, I appreciate that you guys are in teenaged years, but if any of these things have applied to you, perhaps because it was to do with your parents, or perhaps because you directly had to perhaps care for somebody, I don't know. Oh, don't forget that one. Don't forget the menopause. Oh, flipping heck. Us women, eh? If any of these have applied to you or directly affected you in some way, make a tally. Giving you a moment. I hope I'm not going too fast. This was how fast when I practiced it with my other half. This is how fast you need me to go. Okay. Next one. Any of these directly apply to you? I would guess probably not.
Katie, we've had someone ask if you can go to the previous slide. I'm not sure if that was the first or the second, but...
Let me do a little review. That's okay.
Thanks.
That was the first slide. Then... Oh, the second slide. Oh, plus menopause. I always forget menopause. Okay. And then this is the last slide. If you haven't read all of them, don't worry. It's not the end of the world. I'm making a point, you'll see in a sec. Okay, it's going. So I'm interested to know what people's tally scores were. Like I said, it's not a competition. No, I don't want people to have really high tally scores at all. That was 26 big life things that I could just think of off the top of my head that happen to people that are a bit difficult to deal with, not always nice. I want to know what your number is. And I'm going to do a mentee, which is what I did earlier. Oops. Come on. It's half asleep. There it is. Okay. Oh, people have already done that. That's very sensible. is interesting watching the numbers just tick along. Interestingly, well, I think interestingly, you'll notice that most people are putting between 1 to 4 and 5 to 8, which is really, you know, reassuring that people haven't had a huge number of difficult things to deal with in their lives. A couple of people have said 21 to 26. I am sorry. I'm sorry that is the case. You'll see in a second. This is what I was expecting, though. Most people are in the kind of 1 to 4, 5 to 8 region. Okay, you can carry on adding if you'd like, but I'm going to go back to my other presentation. Okay, so whatever your number is, the patients, if you guys become doctors, your patients' numbers will be higher and will be different and will be hugely varied. And in the last 4 years, I've comfortably dealt with all of those 26 things several times over and more, but my tally number was probably, I think it was about 7. So the idea of this is, how do we know how something feels unless we're going through it ourselves? How? I don't know. Mystery. And I've written this a little bit ironically. The idea is that actually we have to find ways, if we're going to look after people and deal with all this difficult stuff and be their doctors, we have to find ways to open our minds to this huge range of different things that happen in a human's life. Yikes. We will be discussing empathy later. We'll come back to that. So yes, doctors are involved in all of that, unsurprisingly. It's not just a case of, you've got a heart problem, here's a medication, you are fixed, goodbye. It is a case of difficult discussions with patients, with their close family and their friends, which can sometimes be even more difficult than the ones with the patients. And we start difficult discussions, we respond to them, we help them along, we might resolve them, that's nice. We try not to make everything 100 times worse, which is surprisingly easy. Now, I said I was a GP trainee. I was on a home visit a couple of weeks ago with this lady who was very, very ill in bed and she was dying. And I said to the chap who was in the room, who's her family member, I'm ever so sorry about how ill your mother is. And he said, well, that's my wife. We'll move on. So you can make things awkward, I'll put it that way. So my experience as a junior doctor, as I've just given you a small excerpt of, when I was an F1, I'm not an F1 anymore. When I was an F1 or a house officer or just starting after 5 years of medical school, I was very inexperienced, I'll give you that. I didn't have all these 26 life things that I'd been through. And I had to suddenly talk to all these patients about all these quite big things, often on my own, interestingly. And I wanted to do it well. And it is difficult to do it well and it does take practice. And I always remember, these are my first times that I always remember. So the first time I, for example, told a family that their relative had died, that was super hard, super hard. The first time I told somebody about their terminal cancer diagnosis, funny enough, it was hard, but the chap was from Barnsley and he just went, oh, that's it then, isn't it? Apparently. This was an interesting one. When I was on my paediatric placement, I actually had a discussion with the mother, or actually the parents of a newborn, on a neonatal intensive care unit, which basically implies that your baby that you've just had is not very well. That was really hard. The first time I took a history from a teenager who was self-harming, that was really sad, actually. And the first time I asked a 72-year-old lady about her sex life, it was much more awkward. It was awkward for both of us, but it was much more awkward for me, I must say. she was great. So I want to talk to you about what I call an appendage that I have grown, not literally a metaphorical appendage, which helps for all of these difficult things that I'm talking to patients and their families about. So I grew a basket. And this basket is something that will hold sad, bad things. So the idea is that you have a metaphorical basket that you offer to your patients, not by saying I have a basket, that's just silly, but by the way that you speak to them and the way that you look after them, that implies, look, I have a big empty basket. I can carry all this sad, bad stuff that we're talking about. I'm here. Let me help you carry it. I think it works. We're going to come back to that. What I'm going to talk about now is, so how on earth do we do these conversations? And actually there are some models, communication models, that help us do these conversations. My favorite one is the one that's called Spikes, which was originally for breaking bad news, because we talk about lots of different things with patients, but breaking bad news is one of the classic difficult things to do when you're communicating with a patient. So Spikes stands for setting up. So you want to have a conversation with your patient. It's going to be difficult. You make sure that you've got a nice quiet room. You know what you're going to say. You have relatives there if you're going to want support for the patient. Maybe you have a nurse or a healthcare assistant there to be generally supportive as well. You make sure that you have a nice chat with them and you build a rapport with them when you introduce yourself. Perception is what P stands for. Then you sort of have this chat about, okay, so obviously we need to talk about something that's difficult. What is your understanding of what's happened so far? You know, what do you perceive to be happening with, for example, this possible diagnosis you have, or this problem with your mental health, or whatever it is? You invite them, if they would like, to tell you whether they want to talk about that today, because you can't force anyone to do anything. Then the K is for knowledge. And sometimes there are some hard facts that need to be said, fair enough. And you want to say these gently and clearly. And then the E is for empathy, which we'll talk about a little bit later, but basically the emotions. How is someone responding? Can you be supportive of that? Can you appreciate what emotions they're having and then help them to understand them? And then at the end, the S of this model is for summary and strategy. So this is what we've talked about. Here's our plan for what we're going to do next. We're not just going to leave you in a void of sadness. We have doctors and nurses usually have a plan for how they're going to help people and what they're going to do. Even if it's like a terminal cancer diagnosis, there's always something we can do to support people. And what I actually do is a sort of simplified version of this. And it's quite similar, I think, but hopefully it'll explain it a bit better. So picture the scene. You've got your person there and you need to do a difficult conversation with them, and you sort of planned it a little bit. And you go in and you make sure you've got the right person. You say who you are. You say why you're there. I always say, so what do you understand about things so far? So this is the perception bit. And also I quite like asking, in terms of perception, how do you feel about it? So an example might be, your mum's been in hospital for 3 weeks now, and, you know, obviously you've seen her very ill. How are you feeling about all of that? And then a warning shot, and then the big thing that needs to be discussed or asked about or explained to them. I'll come on to warning shots later, but some classically good ones are, I have some bad news, or unfortunately, I have something I have to tell you. And it makes somebody just go, oh, okay, there's some serious stuff going on here. I need to take in whatever comes next. I need to listen to it. And it might be bad. Prepare myself.
Can we just go back? I've got a few people asking if you could go back to the last slide just so they can have a look at the spikes.
It will be on the recording, won't it? And you can just Google it. I've actually got some further reading for you guys to have a look at, and it's on there. Take a picture of it with your phone, if that's easier. Okay, I'm going to move on. If that's okay. Okay, another warning shot and discuss. Okay, and then once I've done the discussion or the explanation or the whatever it was that was difficult, the big thing, if needed, I might draw something to explain what I've said, or I might offer a leaflet to help them with whatever we've just talked about. I might perhaps even write some words down, like, for example, I'm really sorry, but you have this type of cancer, and write what the name of the cancer is down, for example. This is where I offer the basket. Okay, we've talked about some really difficult stuff today. How are you feeling about all of that? You know, what's going through your head at the moment? Is there anything I can help with? And then this idea of sort of some sort of future planning. You're not just left in a sea of upset and don't know what's going on. I'm trying to provide a little bit of stability. Well, here's what's going to happen next. Now, this bit here, this isn't to do with the patient being in the room. So the patient leaves the room, or the relative leaves the room, or you leave the setting where you've been having a chat with them. And afterwards, particularly if it was really sad, you have to just take a moment to process what's happened. And it's helpful to debrief, which is where you talk to somebody else about what's just happened. Now, the easy and classic example of this is, I've just had a chat with Mrs. So-and-so down the way about her, you know, the fact that she's not going to get better. Come into the doctor's office and go, oh, that was rubbish. Oh, I feel sad now. And everyone go, oh, are you all right? And I'm like, I'll be fine. But just that makes you feel a little bit better. Some useful stock phrases that I use. I imagine this must be difficult for you. Anyone would have trouble with this or find this upsetting, kind of normalizing it. Do you want me to go over anything again? That's very important, because sometimes when you've given someone lots of information, they might have missed some of it. And we've talked about some difficult things today, but if you think of anything later that you want to ask or to find out, here's how you can do that. So, you know, talk to this person, phone this number, go on this website, for example. And always have a tissue box nearby. It's terrible when you are sitting and talking to someone who's just told you all about how they, you know, are feeling really suicidal after their mum's died, and you don't have a tissue box and they're just crying, and it's just terrible. Just always have a tissue box nearby. Now, fake it till you make it. All these lovely phrases I've just given to you. I mean, quite frankly, the first 25 times or so I said any of these, I felt ridiculous, because, you know, I'm a 23, 24 year old person saying all this. I imagine this must be difficult for you. Who am I? You know, who am I to say that? Who gives a whatever? Why are you saying that? But actually, once you've practiced saying it a few times, you really believe the words and they come out a bit more naturally, if that helps. Okay, all of this, put my little emojis on the screen. All of these things I've just spoken about, like how we structure the consultation or the communication or the conversation. The idea behind all of this is that there is a sad patient on the left who is thinking all these stressful things about what's happening in this conversation. You know, they're upset, things are going on. It doesn't make sense what's going on. And here's your caring doctor in the bottom right-hand corner. And a good doctor, a good communicator, will ask questions that allow the doctor to work out what's going on in the patient's head and make that little bridge. You know, where are you with this? What are you thinking now? I want to understand what's going through your head. Okay, so a little bit on the practicalities. So words. I might be telling grandma how to suck eggs here, but you have to be careful about how you phrase things. There's a lot of different things that we talk about that are difficult. I can't give you a phrase for all of them. But just generally, if you are taking a history, so asking a patient questions about something that's hard that you want to know about, if you are giving them information, delivering bad news, or even exploring a difficult experience that's happened, you have to be careful about your words and you have to be careful about your tone of voice. You can ask questions sensitively, difficult questions, like you can ask, you know, are you scared about dying? You can ask that, but you just have to ask it sensitively, in a nice way. And always be honest. Don't sugarcoat things if there's nothing to sugarcoat. Don't give false hope. An F1 I was working with was like, you're going to be fine. No, don't say that. That's a bad false promise to make. No. So be honest. Do not do that. That's not a very good way of breaking bad news. That is a little bit better. I'm afraid you have cancer. Please don't do that. That's not very good either. People don't like that, usually. Maybe perhaps phrase it, I'm sorry, but this illness is terminal and you'll likely die from this. Bit nicer. Bit of a warning shot. So think before you speak. Silence is good if you really don't know what to say. So if I'm often in a situation where someone's a bit upset and I'm like, I'm lost for words now, I don't know what to say to them. Just use silence strategically, you know, just have a pause and look like you mean it while you're stalling to work out what to say next. And actually, this is the most useful one, I think, out of this whole thing. If it was my family, how would I like this news to have been imparted? Or how would I have liked the doctor to have spoken to someone who was in my family or close to me? And I have circled the word die here, because using the word dying and death when you are talking about dying and death is a lot better than using kind of vague, oh, they're passing on, or oh, they've gone. That is, to someone who's very upset and trying to take news in, that can be too vague. So you use the word die, but you use it sensitively. And then body language. Again, this might be obvious. This is no-nos for body language, you know. Oh, yeah, I'm sorry, but I'm afraid you're dying. So don't do that. That's not good. These are obvious, but sometimes I have to remind myself of them, because if I don't, then I don't do them, because I might be feeling stressed out in a difficult conversation with a patient and I automatically go, oh, dear, I'm feeling stressed out. So you have to make yourself do these things sometimes. And in terms of the contact, which sometimes takes practice, if someone's crying, I often want to be like, oh, I'll put my hand on your hand or my hand on your arm to just be like, I'm here for you. But you have to practice doing that, because if you aren't very skilled at that, then it just looks weird. It's just weird. So that takes a bit of practice. And your body language should say, I am a strong, supportive person who is here for you, and have an empty basket where you can help you carry all this sad stuff. So empathy. So my definition of empathy is that you feel a little bit of what the other person is feeling, and that helps you understand them and also respond to them, because you felt a little bit of it in a, like a caring way, how you might want to be responded to. I get you. So remember that sad or difficult conversation that you wrote down earlier. I want you to think, if you can remember, how did you actually feel when the thing happened, or the difficult conversation was had, the sad thing went on? How did you feel? I'm not going to do a mentee, just write them down on the piece, of paper. Have a little think. Sometimes it's quite difficult to remember how we felt in a situation. I'll tell you, one of the stories later is about how one of the chaps reacted. He was very upset. Perhaps you've written down words like sad, or I burst into tears, for example. Angry, perhaps. Shocked. Embarrassed, maybe even, or ashamed. Numb. Sometimes people don't feel anything. They just feel totally detached and numb and like dissociated from the situation. So there's a really wide range of possible emotions. I expect everyone's written down something like sad, but also possibly something else. And it's impossible for us to know before, unless we know the patient, before we talk to them or the patient's family, how they're going to respond. So we have to tune into what happens when we talk about the difficult things, and then respond to it. Just a brief word on this, because I'm assuming that quite a few people here will be from what we call widening participation backgrounds. That's what the point of this talk is. It's for, it's an outreach program that Brighton and Sussex Medical School run. What I can say from experience is, and I've written this down so I get it right, if you've attended, say, a state school or a comprehensive school, or in my case, a super dodgy school, that's how I've described it, I won't tell you which one, you might have potentially this widening participation criteria, which I didn't even know what that was. I didn't know that existed until I realised that I fitted some of those. And it's just normal. And then when you go to medical school, you meet lots of other future doctors who maybe had a very nice school they went to where their parents paid for it, or their family has quite a lot of money and they've never had to worry about things like money. And perhaps there's just a different background that you've come from. And I have plenty of friends who have this background, but I am different. I have a different background. But what I will say is that empathizing with people who remind you of the person you sat next to in school, or your mum's best friend, or your granny, or that man down the road who runs the corner shop. Empathizing with those people is easier if you have a similar background. And that is actually the majority of our patients. It's the majority of our patients. So just a little word on that. Okay, a quick word on the science, and I'm keeping an eye on the time. Empathy is interesting because that idea of understanding how somebody else feels, we can see it happening in the brain, which I think is really cool. So this one here, where it says self, this is taken from a study called Love Hurts, which is hilariously named. I think they're very clever. This is somebody's MRI scan showing the areas that light up when someone watches a video of hurt or pain happening to someone. I think it's like a hand or a foot. And they have to imagine that it's their self, themselves, that it's happening to. This is the areas that light up when they imagine pain happening to themselves. This is the area that lights up when the same person imagines that painful thing they can see on a video happening to their loved one. So surprisingly, quite similar areas light up. It's not happening to them, it's happening to somebody else, but they're still interpreting it in quite a similar way. And this is the same with a stranger. It's less so because you care less, slightly less about a stranger, a person you don't know, but it's still lighting up. It's still the same experience as if you were having it, and it's lighting up in this, a similar, if not quite the same intensity, similar way. I thought that was interesting. And the frontal lobe and the limbic system, these are the areas of our brain which are a lot to do with personality and thoughts, conscious thought and emotions. Right, looking after ourselves. So we have to find a way to stay afloat, because talking about all this difficult stuff with people who often become upset when you talk about difficult stuff, that's quite a lot to take on board. And we have to find a way of looking after ourselves. These are the range of potential emotions that I go through in just one morning, perhaps. Sometimes doctors feel guilt. They feel guilty that they have perhaps failed their patient, they haven't been able to help, or they feel like they're being blamed for whatever the bad news is that they've delivered, even though it's not their fault. They can feel distress just because the person in front of them might be very distressed and upset. And you take a bit of that on, you feel it in the same part of your brain, or helpless to help them. And these emotions are very heavy, so you can feel the weight of these sad things happening. And actually sometimes it brings up personal sadness. So when my granny died and I had to go and speak to a lady who looked a bit like her, had a similar condition to her and actually was also dying, I had to kind of like realise that I was getting a little bit of that personal sadness and deal with that appropriately, understand it, process it, look at it and go, that's okay, I understand why I'm feeling like that. Sometimes people just feel detachment. Sometimes people completely detach. They can't handle the fact that this person is terribly sad. So they just go, I am numb, I am detached. I will squash it down and not think about it. I'm not saying that's the right way to deal with it, but it does happen. So these things are important, as I just mentioned, emptying the basket. That personal sadness that I felt, I had to look at it in my basket and go, okay, that's there, I feel sad, I've had a little cry, I've dealt with it, I'm emptying it out. And debriefing helps us to do this. And self-care, you guys, I'm sure you all know what self-care means, but relaxation, having a nice time doing a hobby that you like, spending time with people that you like, whether on Zoom or in person. These are important things to help you stay well when you're doing these difficult things, you see. Okay, story time. Oh, I have time. Okay, right. Are you sitting comfortably? Okay, so I'm just going to tell you some stories about some people that I've had difficult conversations with. My first one, this chap called Craig, not actually his name. Hang on, I've been neglecting the chat. I'm hoping there's not anything on it. It's okay, there's some questions, but it's... I will look at the questions later. Okay, we're nearly done now, by the way. So my first chap, who I remember very clearly in my mind, was a chap called Craig. So it was but 2 years ago I was on a general medical ward and my crash bleep, the bleeper, you know, the pages that we have, went off and it went haywire and it said cardiac arrest on this ward. So I sort of walked quickly slash jogged there. And I came to the bed of a lady who was called, not actually called, but Janet, we'll call her Janet, 67-year-old Janet. And she was lying on the bed and she was, to be quite honest, looking blue. She looked blue, which is not obviously not ideal. There were already a few people there and we basically did CPR on her to try and get her heart started again because her heart had stopped and that was why she was looking blue. We did chest compressions, we did various things and we worked on her for a while, like I think it was about half an hour. And it was clear that things were not improving and that we weren't going to get her back. So when the medical registrar said, you know, I'm calling it time of death, someone had to go and speak to her son, Craig, who at the time that she had collapsed and gone blue, had been sitting on her bed with a couple of Costa coffees and they'd been doing the crossword and she had just collapsed. She'd just fallen back on the bed. So he called for help and then he was asked to go and sit outside because it's not that nice to watch CPR on someone you love. And I went out to him and I found him sitting in the patient's dining area, which is quite quiet. And I got one of the nurses to come with me too. And I just said to him, you know, I've come to talk to you. I need to know what you understand has happened with your mum when she collapsed on the bed. And he said, oh, I think she was just having a funny turn. So I sort of had to sit him down and I said, I have some really bad news for you. Is that okay? Can I tell you what's happened to your mum? He said, yes, yes, tell me. When she's collapsed, I said, her heart stopped. And we spent quite a long time trying to get her heart to start again, but we haven't been able to do that. And she's died. And his immediate reaction to this was, he looked at me, sort of kind of disbelieving. And then when I said that she died, that sort of hit home. And he stood up out of his chair and he paced up and down the room and he sort of pressed his hands into his face like this. And he said, God, very loudly, which made us all jump. And he said, why? Why has this happened now? Why are you telling me this? Why haven't you been able to get her back? And I could see he was clearly angry. So I sort of used silence strategically. And I sat there and I just sort of went, you know, nodded and looked sad for him. And I said to him, I'm really sorry this has happened. And we really did do everything that we could. And then I sort of left him for a little bit. I think he wanted to be on his own. I went away. And I came back in a little bit and he'd managed to phone his family who were coming in, which was good to support him and to say goodbye to her. And we sat down and I explained what would happen now, because when someone dies in hospital, there are several things that have to happen. And at the end of all that, he did say thank you, which I appreciated. He wasn't so angry. So that was Craig. Okay, next one. So on my GP job about 6 months ago, I was just asked to call somebody who was having trouble sleeping. And this 50-year-old chap called John, I phoned him up and I said, you know, tell me about what's the problem with your sleeping. And he was telling me all about it and he sounded pretty down. And whilst he was talking, I was scrolling through his previous history, as you can. When you're on the phone with someone, you can do things on the computer, which is useful. And I saw that he did have a history of a major depressive episode in the past. And I just said to him, this sleeping problem you're having, it sounds awful. How are you dealing with it? How is it affecting you? And he said, well, if I'm honest, I do feel pretty down about it. I don't think I'm coping very well with it. And the fact that he was male and single and didn't have any children, it's terribly stereotypical, but those are risk factors for having trouble with your mental health and for feeling really low. It just is. That's just how it works, the evidence shows. So we spoke about his mood and he was feeling very hopeless And he was also feeling very guilty about the fact that, so he was gay, and his mother, who had just died, had never accepted that. And he was struggling to come to terms with the fact that she died and he couldn't speak to her anymore, and she'd never quite been happy with who he was as a person. And that had meant that he couldn't be happy with who he was. And so I said to him, can I ask you something that I ask everybody who suffers with their mood? Can I ask you if you've thought about hurting yourself at all? And he said, actually, yes, I have. This morning, I went and I bought several boxes of paracetamol from different pharmacies. And I've really thought about taking as many as I can and drinking two bottles of whiskey at the same time, because I don't think I want to live anymore. I'm going to tidy everything up this week and put everything in order just in case I want to do it this week. And I said, is there anything that stops you from wanting to do it? Makes you not want to? And he said, not really, just the nagging thought that there must be some way to feel better that I don't know about. And I think that made me feel really sad. There was this chap who was on the other end of the phone who was really suffering, and I ended up bringing him in the end to talk to him properly about it in person. And I called the mental health crisis team, and we made a plan with John that they would get in touch with him and support him. And I saw him quite regularly after that. I started him on antidepressants, referred him for talking therapy, and actually a few months later, he actually feels quite a lot better. And he has hope, and he doesn't want to kill himself anymore. And he's got some really nice plans for the future. Yay. That was nice. But a sad conversation. The last one, it's a little bit out there. It's definitely a difficult conversation, but this one was initiated by Eileen rather than me. So Eileen was one of the ladies who was on my care of the elderly ward that I used to work on a couple of years ago. And I popped over to her bed. She had a bed by the window, and I was doing my ward round. So I popped over to have a little chat. I said, how are you doing, Eileen? How are things today? And she says, I'm thoughtful. I just want you to tell me, how long do you think I've got? And I sort of looked at her and I said, it's difficult to say. And because Eileen had terminal bowel cancer, she'd sort of been thinking about this idea of how dying would work for a while. And she said, I really want to talk about it with someone, how long I've got and what dying will be like. But it's really no good talking to my daughters because they keep getting all weepy and crying when I bring it up. And it's terribly frustrating. So I wondered if I could ask you about it. So we had actually quite a good discussion about what dying was like and how you become more and more sleepy towards the end, and how usually, unless something suddenly happens, if you have cancer like an infection or a blood clot, or even bowel obstruction, because she had bowel cancer, usually it's quite a slow and quiet process, rather than lots of things happening and people running around. And I did actually ask her if I could speak to her about her resuscitation, because you might have heard of the do not resuscitate form. It's something that we talk to patients about because it's quite important to do that right and not do resuscitation on people that it won't work on, because it's not very nice. So I said to her, would it be all right if we spoke about that? And I said, if your cancer continues to progress as it is, and you get to the end of your life, your heart will stop. And when that happens, if we were to try and do things like chest compressions and put airways tubes in your mouth and all that kind of thing, I don't think it would work. I don't think it would bring you back. And she said, and I was about to do my spiel, which I have a spiel for this kind of thing where I go, and this, and this. And before I could say anything else, she went, oh God, please, no, I don't want any of that. I want to go peacefully. I want to have my family around me. And I want to just have that last quiet moment with them. Because after I go, they're all going to start arguing about my house and who gets it. So I quite like that one. That was just to show Eileen was the instigator of that particularly difficult conversation. Okay, story time is over. I hope you enjoyed that. And now we debrief. So Everybody just think to yourself, oh God, we've talked about all sorts of things today. I hope you aren't feeling terribly gloomy, but particularly if you've had to root through some experiences in your life to think about, you know, what was that awkward conversation you had, or what was that sad thing that you talked about? How do you feel? Just think to yourself now, how do I feel? How do I feel about it? We're going to make sure our baskets aren't too heavy. Ooh, empty them out. There we go. And actually, I was saying earlier, I regularly debrief about sad, bad discussions. The most recent time, I had a great big old cry. I had this 15-year-old girl come in, and she was telling me, the one I mentioned earlier, she was telling me about how she was self-harming. And I really identified with her. She was a bit like me when I was 15. And I just felt really sad. I was like, I'm so sad that she hasn't got that kind of support and this has happened to her. I feel really sad about it. I had to have a big cry with my lovely GP supervisor, who was completely fine about me having a cry. And I felt a lot better afterwards. And I'm pleased to say, by the way, she's doing a lot better now. She's much more supported. Okay, let's do a mentimeter. Is everyone still awake? No, maybe. Okay, I just want you to tell me, in a sentence, how do you feel about the difficult topics that we've talked about today? And it's anonymous. We're debriefing together, a collective debrief. Oh, empowered. Oh, this is great. This is good. I'm glad. I was hoping people would say, I feel fine. It's been really interesting. I'm glad. Really, it's just a process to deal with it. Fine. I like that we keep it real. Me too. A-okay. I have learned whilst doing Zoom and online talks that you have to just sit for a while and let things happen when people are typing. Well, I can't see the bottom of that one. Very insightful. Okay. Reassured. Good. Oh. Like, I just had a huge cry, but I haven't. Well, it told me. When I clicked on it, it told me. It. That's interesting. Yes, I know what that feels like. You're like, oh, that feeling. Any more. I can't make it scroll any quicker. I want to, but I can't. A bit enlightened. That's good. Oh, scared of dying. Oh, no. Oh, I'm sorry. You feel scared of dying. Some of it at home. Better about approaching it. You're fine. People are like, I'm fine. Don't worry about me. I'm all good. Good to share feelings. Shocking. Oh dear. I am sorry if it was a bit shocking. I suppose I was very shocked when I got into my third year of medical school and I ended up listening to all these conversations going on around me that were really hard. I didn't perhaps expect that when I was applying for medical school. I didn't expect that to be such a big part of it. So maybe it's not a bad thing to be a little bit shocked. You're more informed, exactly. My perspective. Oh, you guys are all lovely. I'm appreciating this. I'm glad that we're debriefing. This is a good collective debrief. Okay, I'm going to leave that going. I might look at it a little bit later, but carry on. I'll read them. I'm going to go back to my last slide because I'm aware it's 7:30 and we might have some things to do at the end and some questions to answer. Okay. Oh, yes, I want to post. Yes. Right. I am at the end of my talk. So my last parting word is that actually when you do difficult discussions well and you do them really well and you know that the person you've just spoken to is super sad, but actually you were very kind and supportive and it had to happen. And at least you know that the difficult conversation, you were really nice about it. That's actually really rewarding. It makes you feel good. It makes you feel sad, but it makes you feel good. And it's like one of my favourite parts of the job, doing it well. Sounds odd, but it is. Thank you very much for listening. I mean, you might not have listened, I wouldn't know. But thank you anyway, if you have. If you have any questions, I can see them popping up in the Q&A thingamabob. You don't have to stay for the Q&A. I'm really appreciative that you've come. That's my email. That's my Twitter. I don't say anything interesting on Twitter, just to warn you. And Alice and the team will have emailed you out a resources sheet. If you have been affected by anything that we've talked about, if you are feeling sad, there are plenty of places to get some advice and self-care. And I hope you haven't. You guys seem mostly okay, which is good. And that's it. Thank you.